My name is Matt Naylor, and I'm the President and CEO here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and we're just delighted to have you. There's a good buzz in the room, and we're just really pleased to have you here at this final of five in the series of this outstanding speaker series, the last of those. So it's my privilege to welcome you on behalf of the Midwest Center for Holocaust Education, the National Archives of Kansas City, and the National World War I Museum and Memorial. And it's been a terrific partnership, the second year in a row that we've done this together. And I think that we can all say what a rich speaker series this has been, as well as an outstanding exhibition, as well as that of last year's also. If you're new, if this is the first time you've been here, welcome. If you're less familiar with the museum, we'd certainly invite you to come back and see the exhibitions. We have three levels here at the museum, and four exhibition galleries. And so we'd invite you at any time to come back and see those, as well as when your family's in, bring them here, or take in the iconic views from the observation deck. You'll see photograph over photograph after photograph of the skyline of Kansas City, and lo and behold, it's taken from here. So you can have it in real person. So we'd invite you to do that and make this your part of your family tradition. These five programs are offered to enhance the exhibition Discovery and Recovery, Preserving Iraqi Jewish Heritage, for which Kansas City was the first of only four venues to host this treasure trove of documents and artifacts. It's a very limited tour. And the archive would no doubt have been lost if it were not for random discovery by a US Army team of the flooded basement in Saddam Hussein's intelligence center in 2003. And the exhibition closes this weekend, so if you haven't taken that in, do. If you have seen it, it's worth seeing again. It's very interesting, as those of you who have seen it would attest to. It's open from 8 o'clock until 4 o'clock tomorrow through Saturday, and then it's gone. You'd have to go to another city. So we'd invite you to see that. It's only because of the generous support of the trusts and foundations and donors that we're able to bring this to you and bring the exhibition as well, but particularly the speaker series. And so I want tonight to call those out. They're on the evaluation form that we invite you to complete at the end. Many of you do, and we really appreciate receiving that information. But for a moment, let us pause to thank the Community Legacy Fund, the Oppenstein Brothers Foundation, Soslin Foundation, H&R Block Foundation, Arvin Gottlieb Charitable Foundation, J-Lead, Sprint Foundation, Annette and Sam and Jack Schwinberg Charitable Foundation, Flo Harris Supporting Foundation, Earl and Leonie Trennan Special Fund, Menorah Legacy Foundation, Harry Portman and the Harry Portman Charitable Trust. Additional support is provided by the Jewish Art Fund. You know, these things can only happen with the philanthropic support of individuals, generous individuals, including those that we listed, so please join me in thanking them. And of course, to the donors of the National World War I Museum and Memorial, despite the fact that we carry the national designation for the museum and the memorial, we receive no federal funding. So your support of this place is also what helps make this possible. Although the series concludes tonight, there's another in the program that I want to call your attention to. On Wednesday, August 26th at 7 o'clock at the Jewish Center for Holocaust Education will present a free film at the White Theater at the Jewish Community Campus, Forgotten Refugees, Story of the Million Jews from Arab Countries in North Africa during the 20th century who were forced to emigrate. And I'm sure it's an outstanding movie. So we'd invite you to that on August the 26th. There is information flyers available as you leave and as you conclude the fill in your evaluation form. So it's really my pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, to welcome you to this, our final series. It's been outstanding. We're so glad to have you here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial to have these important conversations about what has in part defined the 20th century. And so now it's my pleasure to call to the podium and introduce to you the executive director, the curator of this speaker series, the director of the Midwest Center for Holocaust Education, Jean Zeldin, who will introduce tonight's speaker.
I've been called many things, but never the curator of a speaker series. Thank you, Matt. And so far I've been the silent partner in this, which is not my normal role, but I did want to take the opportunity tonight to thank again the National Archives at Kansas City, who brought this exhibition to our attention and invited us in, and to the National World War I Museum for allowing us to use this space, and both of you for being such great partners. What Matt didn't mention is that the reason that Kansas City was chosen as the first of the four cities on this limited tour is because of our community's response to the previous exhibitions that we had brought in on deadly medicine and Nazi propaganda. So we owe this to all of you who have been so supportive of these programs. I also want to recognize Arvin Zwick, whom I can't see through the light, but Arvin has been recording each of these speaker programs and preparing them for podcasts on our website. So we'll, you know, let you know as best we can when all of those are completed, but it should be in the next couple of weeks, I would imagine. So 14 months later, two exhibitions later, and 12 speaker programs later, here we are. And as the person who was responsible for writing the grant proposals to fund these last two projects, I want to double down on Matt's comment, thanking the foundations, trusts, and individuals without whose generosity this would not have been possible. I'm not going to read them again, but we are extremely grateful. And many of these organizations and foundations provided funding for both of these the last two exhibits. On a more personal note, in June of 1994, Dorothy from Kansas traveled to Washington, D.C. to meet the Wizard of Oz. Well, that was pretty much how I felt when I first met Dr. Michael Berenbaum, at the time director of the United States Holocaust Research Institute at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, which had opened the year prior. From 1988 to 1993, he had served as project director of the museum, overseeing its creation. He also served as deputy director of the President's Commission on the Holocaust, where he authored the report to the President. A few years later, we reconnected in Los Angeles when he was president and CEO of the Survivors of the Shoah Visual History Foundation, which at that time was operating out of a trailer in the back lot of Universal Studios. As our paths continued to cross, we evolved from Dr. Berenbaum to a first name basis, yet having the opportunity to learn from Michael at conferences in Philadelphia, Jerusalem, Montreal, and Las Vegas, to name a few, I'm no less in awe of his brilliant mind and caring nature. Michael Berenbaum is a renowned writer, lecturer, and teacher, consulting in the conceptual development of museums and the development of historical film. He's director of the Sigi Zierring Institute, exploring the ethical and religious implications of the Holocaust at the American Jewish University in Los Angeles, where he is also a professor of Jewish studies. He's been featured on Nightline and the Today Show, as well as National Public Television. You may recognize him from various films in which he has appeared as well. Michael's the author and editor of 20 books, it may be more by now, but at least 20 books, scores of scholarly articles, and hundreds of journalistic pieces. For his work in journalism, he won the Simon Rockauer Memorial Award of the American Jewish Press Association three times in three different categories during a two-year period. Yeah. In film, he was co-producer of One Survivor Remembers, the Gerda Weissman Klein story, which was recognized with an Academy Award, an Emmy Award, and a Cable Ace Award. I think a lot of us remember Gerda Klein at the Academy Awards, that they didn't dare give her the cane as she went on and on and on. It was a real, very touching moment. Michael was historical consultant on the Shoah Foundation's documentary, The Last Days, which I highly recommend. It won an Academy Award for Best Feature-Length Documentary in 1998. And he served as an historical consultant or chief historical consultant for HBO's Conspiracy, which we'll be showing sometime after the first of the year in our film series. It was nominated for 10 Emmy Awards, and The Holocaust, The Untold Story, which won the Golden Eagle Award and a silver medal at the U.S. International Film and Video Festival. More recently, Michael was the conceptual developer on the Illinois Holocaust Museum and Education Center in Skokie, and conceptual developer and chief curator of the Belzec Memorial at the site of the death camp. He's currently at work on the Memorial Museum to Macedonian Jewry. Apparently the man does not sleep, except perhaps on airplanes. Closer to home, Michael reviewed MCHE's documentary, The Holocaust Through Our Own Eyes, endorsed our book, From the Heart, and presented at an MCHE teacher education course offered in partnership with the Truman Library. This is only the cliff notes of what Michael has accomplished. I could go on and on about the accolades he's received, but most of all, Michael Berenbaum is a mensch and a mentor to many. It is an honor and a privilege to call him a friend and to welcome him back to Kansas City.
They have mic'd me up with one of these new head things, so as long as I don't trip over myself, I'll be all right. First of all, Gene, thank you for an overly kind introduction. You know, years ago I would say that I'm sorry my father's not here. He would be impressed. My mother might actually believe it. But I can say this as the father of two teenagers, they know better. And the one thing you left out, which is what has come home to roost on that, two personal stories. Number one, I edited the second edition of the Encyclopedia Judaica, 22 volumes, 16 million words, lots of stuff. And my teenage kids have now come to the thing, gee, it's remarkable how much you've forgotten. But the second is that many, many years ago, and this is why I love the last line of your introduction, many years ago, I won an award for the Outstanding Program on Religion and the Media, and we were given a Silver Angel Award. A Silver Angel Award creates a terrible problem, because who can you tell? If you tell your wife you want a Silver Angel Award, she says, would you remember to lift up the toilet seat when you go to the men's room? Or cover the toothpaste? So I did the only honorable thing a man could do under such circumstances, which is I called my mother. I said, Mom, I won the Silver Angel Award. She says, I know you're an angel, now try being a mensch. Just let me tell you, I'm going to... There's a joke around my presentations, which is, let me say a few words before I begin, which in Yiddish sounds better. But let me say a couple things about the exhibition, because I accidentally had a role in this that was very interesting. This exhibition was discovered in one of Saddam Hussein's secret police areas, and it was rotting on the floor. And those were the early days of the invasion of Iraq, when everything was, the early days, the middle days, later days, contemporary days, when everything was enormously tense and everybody was on a tinderbox. And they wanted to get funding for it, so they went to a friend of mine who heard the word archives and said, Michael Berenbaum. So I get a call from Iraq saying, we have discovered the archives of the Jewish community. What do we do with them? And I said, as we talked it through, and they're on one of these radio satellite phones, which means you hear every second word and you're not sure who else in the world is hearing it, so I said, you know, look, first thing I would say is, why don't you bring it to Israel, but I understand you're gonna have a couple of political problems if it ever comes out publicly, that we're taking material out of Iraq and bringing it to Israel. There'll be explosions all over Iraq, and that's not what we needed. There were explosions all over Iraq anyhow, but we didn't need it for that. So I worked out a formula which I had learned from a very interesting case in Holocaust history. I worked out a formula where essentially, it wasn't that my innovation, it was an innovation, I'll tell you that story in a second, in which three Iraqi Jewish exiles wrote a letter to the National Archives asking if they would take temporary custody on loan of the archives of the Jewish community of Iraq in order to preserve them. So technically, you are not seeing material that the National Archives owns. You are seeing material that the National Archive received in loan for preservation purposes only, because they could not be preserved in Iraq. We were not taking the national treasures of Iraq and bring them out of the country, but for preservation and conservation, you are seeing this material. And apparently, I was thrilled to see it, but apparently that fiction worked. One earlier story about that is, and if we have press here, I would prefer that it remain off the record, but it's a story that's worth telling. In the aftermath of the Holocaust in Germany, the assistant for Jewish affairs to General McNardy, who was the chief of the occupying forces in Germany, was a fellow by Rabbi Henry Bernstein, very important man who made Herculean efforts on behalf of Holocaust survivors. His assistant was a man who later became enormously prominent, a man by the name of Rabbi Herbert Friedman. They asked Gershon Scholem, the leading scholar of that generation, to come to Germany and to assess and find and recover the stolen manuscripts of Judaica that the Germans had taken and looted and were either going to destroy or were going to bring into their own institutions. And Gershon Scholem, whom you know is the great scholar of Jewish mysticism, spent about 6 or 8 months in Germany, working in Germany and German and former German occupied countries, working through this material, when all of a sudden they got General McNardy's plane, they brought the material to Jerusalem. And then there was a headline in the Stars and Stripes which said the following, that General McNardy has used his private plane to take millions of dollars worth of German antiquities and sequester them for his own purposes. Not exactly an accurate story, but McNardy calls the two rabbis in, one of them young, one of them senior, and says, gentlemen, this problem will be resolved in 48 hours or you will be court-martialed and shot. I don't care how it's resolved, but you have 48 hours to resolve it. And as you can imagine, for two rabbis to be threatened with a court-martial and shooting, that gave them a little bit of concentration as to how to get out of the situation. And what they decided to do was they decided to offer it to the American consulate in Palestine, which was in Jerusalem, the American consulate in Palestine, this is pre-state Israel, that would then give it on loan to the Jewish National Library, which could preserve this material. And if you ever see any of these rare manuscripts, they're still in the technical possession of the American consulate in Jerusalem, on loan for now about 68 and a half years, on loan to the National Library in Jerusalem. And my assumption is they will be there in 168 years, and in 268 years on loan, but General McNardy did not take the manuscripts for his own reason. So if you learn a little bit from history, you can help preserve material for the future of history. I naturally was sitting comfortably at my desk in Los Angeles and was not threatened with court-martial or shooting. But that's the origin of these archives, and I thought, given my own minor involvement in it, I thought you'd get a little bit of a kick about knowing that. Most of us presumed that the Holocaust was an Ashkenazic phenomenon. And the Ashkenazic phenomenon is essentially because Ashkenazi essentially means German Jew. And essentially, everybody presumes that it is an Ashkenazic phenomenon. But the moment we look at what happened to the Sephardic community under the Holocaust, we see a rich variety of diverse stories. And what I'm going to do is to take you on a little bit of a tour of the horizon of what happened to Sephardic Jewry under the Holocaust. And when I take you on the tour of the horizon, you're going to discover some very interesting things that you should know about, and will pay tribute to the fate of Sephardic Jewry and also to the impact of the Holocaust on Sephardic Jewry. Let me talk for one moment about Iraq. And that is that Iraq had a one-day pogrom on Shavuot of 1941, Shavuot of 5701. It was the Farhud. And this was triggered by a man who had cooperated with the Nazis, the Mufti of Jerusalem. You will hear a lot of talk about the role of the Mufti, the Jewish community, which has, at least some within the Jewish community, wants to exaggerate the role as if he was a chief advisor of Adolf Hitler and Hitler's inspiration for the destruction of the Jews. He was at best, a historically what we can describe as a peripheral figure who disliked Jews, despised Zionism, and was not unimpressed with Hitler's efforts to destroy the Jewish people, wished him all the success. But Hitler needed no inspiration. And in fact, years before he had met the Mufti of Jerusalem, whom he met on a couple of occasions, years before he had advocated the elimination of the Jewish people, meaning their expulsion from Germany and from German lands, et cetera, which later translated into, for reasons we won't go into tonight, into annihilation program, which we call the Holocaust, the mass murder, the final solution of the Jewish problem, the total elimination of the Jewish people. Interestingly enough, the country that denies the Holocaust, or that denied the Holocaust under our good friend Ahmadinejad, was the country whose record during the Holocaust was extraordinary. And that is that if you, and I've written this, so I'll put it to you this way, that I said that if I had one book, and I wouldn't write it because I don't speak the language as well, but if I had one book that I wanted written about 5 years ago, it was the role of Iran during the Holocaust. And I would have said that it is fine that Ahmadinejad does not know the history of Germany. After all, he was the president of Iran. But the idea that he doesn't know the history of his own country and the decency of his own people is really unforgivable. And that is, Iran was, during the Holocaust, a way station for Jews going to Palestine. There were no actions at all against the Jewish community. It had a thriving Jewish community that offered shelter to those who escaped to Iran and used Iran as a means of getting to Palestine. And in fact, there was a great tradition of reasonable hospitality, provided that these Jews didn't stay too long. So the thing with our friend Ahmadinejad, and I trust you understand that I'm putting our friend in quotes a little bit, the thing with Ahmadinejad was he was not only denying the Holocaust, but he was denying the decency and the integrity of his own people. And one of the things to look up when you get a chance to look up is the words on the children of Tehran, which is the way in which this became a way station to freedom for Jews, and not something that Ahmadinejad in particular was happy about. because it really was aiding the rescue of the Jews and aiding the Zionist enterprise at the very same time. But the historical record must commend the Iranian people for the enormously positive role that they played. Let's now look at a much more complex and, in certain respects, a much more interesting situation. And we'll touch on two areas, actually two and a half areas. We'll touch on the area of Greece, and in Greece you have to divide Salonika, Athens, and then the island of Corfu. Now, let me deal with Corfu very simply, because Corfu represents the enormously obsessive character and the lengths to which the Germans went to get rid of the Jews. Let me begin by saying, had there been a Jewish community remaining on Corfu, almost no one in this country would have known about it. In fact, almost no one in this country would know that there was an island called Corfu. The Jews of Corfu were essentially craftsmen, and there was a small Jewish community. And the most interesting thing about the deportation of the Jewish community is Germany had to send, Corfu is an island, they had to send a boat to remove the Jews from Corfu. They then needed a train waiting to receive the Jews at the dock. And they had to transport them through 9 different countries, paying for travel in the native currencies of that country. There was no euro in those days. Paying for track time and train time and clearing the tracks for this 9 different foreign currencies in order to bring them to Auschwitz. The first time they brought the Jews over, the boat did not coordinate with the train. It wasn't going to make it. The sea was a little bit stormy. They couldn't keep the train. And consequently, the Jews were taken back to Corfu. Now, if you were a typical bureaucrat without an obsessive characteristic, you would say, nobody's ever going to discover there were Jews on Corfu. Why should I go through this problem again? Why should I go through all the telegrams? Ladies and gentlemen, there was a time before there was internet and fax. And why should I go through all the telegrams and set this up once again? Why do I have to get clearances for all of these currencies, for all of this track time, etc.? But the obsessive quality was, in essence, that they did it twice. And that is that they wouldn't leave this community of 1,600 alive, but they set up everything, coordinated all of the schedules twice in order to, what, check off Judenrein, no more Jews in Corfu. Jewish community, in essence, in Greece, Greece was judiciously neutral until the Germans invaded it. The Germans then invaded it, and they essentially, in one very brief spring period of 1943, sent all the Jews of the town of Salonika to Auschwitz. Now, Salonika Jewry had a very interesting characteristic. Salonika was so deeply a Jewish town that the ports of Salonika were closed on Shabbat until the period of time at the end of World War I. The Jews were stevedores, the Jews ran the ports, and the ports were closed on Shabbat. They operated on the other days of the week. An intense Jewish community of great renown, a Sephardic Jewish community that spoke Ladino, eliminated in a very, very brief period of time. The Italian zone of occupation was in existence in other sections of Greece, and then the Germans essentially fooled the Jews in Athens, and they fooled the Jews in Athens by saying that they were going to distribute Passover matzot, Jews came for Passover matzot. They forged the stationery and the announcement of the synagogue. Jews came for Passover matzot, and they were greeted by being sent to the death camps. Interestingly enough, many Jews fled to the hills where they were saved by Greece and where the Greek underground worked very well and very successfully with the Jews. Many Jews fought in the resistance. And the other interesting segment about it is the unique story of the Greek Jews who arrive in Auschwitz. They arrive in Auschwitz without any common language with either the perpetrators or the other victims. They don't speak Yiddish. They don't speak German. They don't speak Polish. They speak Greek. The other group, and they speak Ladino. They can't imagine that a Jew doesn't speak Ladino. I'm exaggerating, but not by much. And the other Jews can't imagine that there are Jews who don't speak what? Yiddish. So if you listen to Holocaust testimony, you have a very fascinating thing because their testimony is enormously visual. They go through the camp as if they were deaf. They could get no verbal signals. Remember, people who arrived, if you were a 14-year-old boy, you were told, say you're 16. If you're a 50-year-old man, say you were 40. We have 9 people, one after the other, who were 14 or 13 years old, who were told to step on the toes of their brothers to make themselves taller as they went by selection. Now, that verbal cue literally saved your life. Another example of a verbal cue. Somebody would say, if you were a young woman arriving with your mother and your child, somebody would say to you, give your child to your mother, they will treat her better because she has a child. That would be a verbal cue that you wouldn't understand. You would do it because you were gracious, etc. And you would hear children saying, I don't want to go with Bubby. But that verbal cue essentially understood, as veteran prisoners would say, that women with children were going to be killed, that the old were going to be killed and the very young were going to be killed. And that verbal cue would save your life at selection, but at the cost of what? Separation from your child. You would not knowingly send your child to death, but you would what? Not be able to get a verbal cue. Therefore, the Greeks who arrived without any ability to get verbal cues. They also played a very unique role because they were made into Sonderkommando. They were made into the people who operated in the vicinity of the gas chambers. Not that they were responsible for the gas chambers, but they escorted prisoners to the undressing room. They took the victims out of the gas chamber. Only the Germans put the gas in the gas chamber, which arrived by a Red Cross truck. And only a German doctor pronounced the dead dead. But the Greeks worked in the vicinity because, in part, they couldn't talk. And therefore, they couldn't communicate, and a few of them survived, and their testimony becomes one of the ways in which we understand. Let's take a look now at the area in which I have a newfound expertise, because I'm working on the museum in Macedonia. Let's take a look at the area of the Balkans. We can spend 3 weeks at the Balkans, but you're a nice audience. We don't want to spend 3 weeks. All we can say is that the battles of the Balkans that were started in the 1940s did not conclude until the 1990s. And if we're here in World War I Museum, we could say the battles in the Balkans, which began and precipitated in part World War I, did not conclude, and having just spent considerable time in other parts of the Balkans, one can say that nobody likes the Dayton Accords, but everybody's frightened of overturning them because the consequences are worse. Consequently, you will hear, if you listen carefully, you will hear people despising the outcome of the Dayton Accords. Do you want to change it? Absolutely not, because otherwise we'll kill each other again. Exhausted by war, they therefore settled for a rough, difficult, painful, inadequate, imprecise, miserable peace. But that miserable peace is a little bit better than what they experienced before. One word about the perpetrators in Yugoslavia, which will tell you something very interesting about the perpetrators in Yugoslavia. And I'm talking about the Germans. The Germans developed the use of mobile gas vans in Yugoslavia. The gas vans that they used were the equivalent of moving trucks. And there is a correspondence that dazzles the eyes and shakes the conscience, in which they say, we're going to gas the Jews, but we need essentially the work of mechanics to jerry-rig the moving trucks. How do you jerry-rig the moving truck? And they're using locally obtained equipment to do it. You take a hose and you fasten it to the tailpipe. You take the hose and you fasten it to a hole in the rear. You create a seal and a vacuum. You drive the truck and the gas goes into the compartment. And then they discover two terrible problems. Number one, if you develop in the back of the gas vans, everybody pushes against the rear, and therefore the rear door sometimes opened. And if everybody went by weight to the rear, pushing as hard as they can, the rear axles began to break. Problem was presented not to engineers, but to mechanics. What do you do? You reinforce the rear door, and you reinforce the rear axles. And then you send orders for the new trucks that you're going to buy to do this task. You send, and you seal it more tightly. You send new orders which said we need special reinforced rear axles and double lock, double fastened, double bolted doors. Correspondence of mechanics to engineers back home in the factories of Renault and of Volkswagen. Small details that indicate in a much larger circle what was happening there. Everybody understood what this was. They killed the men. They transported them by gasoline, by vans. They transported them right out of the camps and they killed them. They then had to develop two other things about the gas vans, which become orders for the way in which they're going to be shaped. People apparently, and you'll forgive me for being graphic, but I'm going to be graphic. People apparently who are being gassed lose control of their bowels. Makes cleanup somewhat unpleasant, and I'm understating it. Therefore, what they developed was a hosing system with a drain in the floor that could be lifted so that you could essentially rinse out the truck so it could be reused within an hour. They then developed a second thing, which is that people were smart, they put their hands or some metal or something into the light bulb and they knocked out the fuse of the lighting of the rear of the truck. And sometimes it created a short in the battery and the truck could not continue. Therefore, they reinforced that with type of metallic cover that could not be touched. And you have in meticulous detail the evolution of the mobile gas van. With the small gestures, done solved on the local thing by mechanics with stuff that were bought in the local hardware store, that then became translated into other areas worked. In Yugoslavia, you had two other phenomena that are worth noting, and then we'll touch on Bulgaria and Macedonia. In Yugoslavia, the arrival of the Germans and their invasion was the occasion for the settlement of ethnic warfare, or the seemingly settlement of ethnic warfare, among the warring factions of Yugoslavia. Those of you who know anything about Yugoslavia know, and it's interesting because it's a phenomenon of the contemporary world, know that Yugoslavia essentially was a multi-ethnic state that only Tito could solve. And that's post-war. And in essence, it had a warring between multiple religions and multiple ethnicities. And in areas where the Ustasha controlled, they used it not only to solve their problem solve the local Jewish problem, but they solved the problem with other ethnic groups by the same modality of annihilation, and they had their own camp, which is the closest proximity to the six largely known death camps, and that's Jasenovac. And consequently, what you had there was the catching notion of wartime is a good time and the German presence is a wonderful time to solve our ethnic problems. And you saw the disintegration of Yugoslavia. Ironically, Yugoslavia was one area where there was enormous cooperation between Jewish resistance fighters who worked alongside Yugoslavian resistance fighters, and the number two man to Tito was Moshe Piadi, a fighter whose first name was what? Moshe. Not disguising as some Soviet resistance fighters had to do, or Jews fighting in Poland, not disguising his name, but walking around with the name Moshe and fighting alongside Tito and therefore in resistance. Now you have to hold a very interesting contradiction in your head as we get to Bulgaria. Bulgaria claims itself and dresses itself up as the even more successful as Denmark. 50,000 Jews of Bulgaria were saved. Denmark only saved about 7,500. That's the story Bulgaria tells. But what they don't tell is how the Jews of Bulgaria ended up being saved. Bulgaria became the beneficiary of its alliance with Germany, and it annexed the areas of Thrace and Macedonia. In Thrace and Macedonia, it signed a document consenting to the deportation onto Treblinka of 20,000 Jews, and it deported the Jews of Thrace and Macedonia to Treblinka in March of 1943. The ghettoization and the Germans followed a familiar pattern in Bulgaria. You had the deportation of Jews from their homes in Bitola, in Shtip, and in Skopje. And they were deported to a ghetto called Monopol, which was an old factory, tobacco factory, in the town of Skopje itself. They were there for 3 weeks. The entire experience of ghettoization was 3 weeks. And then they were deported, men, women, and children, to Treblinka. And the men, women, and children who were deported from there to Treblinka were killed. Not 90%, not 95%, not 98%, not 99%, but a full 100% of every Jew who was deported from Macedonia was killed with no survivors. The only people who escaped deportation were 165 Jews who had one of two phenomena about them. Either they were physicians or pharmacists who would have robbed the entire area of Macedonia of its physicians and pharmacists, or they had Spanish citizenship. And they had Spanish citizenship papers. And there were some, a very few, who escaped to Albania. And believe it or not, Albania is the only country in Europe that had more Jews at the end of the war than at the beginning of the war. But before you marvel about Albania, you have to say it had about 200 Jews at the beginning of the war and had about 300 Jews, I may be exaggerating by one or two, 300 Jews at the end of the war, all of whom were beneficiaries of something called BESA, B-E-S-A, which is Albanian Hospitality and Rescue. And Albania rescued about 100 Jews. My favorite story is of my friend Itzik Adizes, whose father pretended to be a Muslim physician. Everybody in the town knew he was not Muslim and he was not a physician, but he was a Jew, but they treated him as a doctor because they needed a doctor, and he knew more about medicine than anyone else in the town. And therefore he was known as doctor. He was able to, you know, heal. He did not operate, but he did all sorts of other things, even though everybody in the entire town knew he was a fraud. He was helped by Christians and Muslims. And his son, ironically, is the leading management consultant in the United States, and Macedonians honored by Ellis Island as the outstanding immigrant to the United States from Macedonia. Saved as a child. When he came back after the war to Skopje, he found other people living in his home who forced him out. He then ended up in Israel and studied management and became, as he migrated to the United States, became a leading management consultant. But the Jews of Thrace and Macedonia were completely destroyed. And then something remarkable happened in Bulgaria. Bulgaria had imposed slave labor camps on Jewish men, special taxes which confiscated Jewish property. And then when it came to the deportation of the Jews, all of a sudden you had something unprecedented in World War II. You had a civic eruption. The lawyers erupted and wrote an open petition. The writers erupted and wrote an open petition. Parliamentarians who had objected to the Jew law and were overwhelmed all of a sudden said, we cannot treat our citizens this way. But they only began to save their own Jews after they had what? Shed the blood of other Jews. Meaning that their innocence came at the boundary line between, we don't give a damn what, this is me talking, not them, we don't give a damn what we do to non-citizens, but our own citizens we can persecute, we can confiscate, we can expropriate, we can do lots of things, but don't deport them. And that, by the way, in the context of the Holocaust, is nothing less than miraculous. But understand that their hands were bloody before there was an eruption from civic society that said, no, we don't do this to our people. It's a fascinating story. It's a fascinating story that makes Bulgaria at once a rescuer and at the other hand a perpetrator. At once a perpetrator who benefited economically and militarily and the like. And by the way, one of the very interesting things is you have the protest of a man by the name of Archbishop Roncalli, Archbishop Roncalli was the papal, the apostolic delegate to Bulgaria, and he later then became he was the papal nuncio in Bulgaria. He later became the apostolic delegate to Turkey, and he wrote to the king of Bulgaria saying that if you are responsible for the deportation of your Jews, your place in heaven will be denied. You will be condemned to eternal damnation. Some of you will already know when I speak of Archbishop Roncalli that I'm speaking about the man that I proudly call a saint of the Roman Catholic Church and a saint of Jewish tradition. That's John the 23rd. In his earlier manifestation, John the 23rd threatened the immortality of the king of Bulgaria to rescue the Jews, and he did so, interestingly enough, and I can document it, he did so without Vatican approval. And this is the man who brought us Nostra Aetate a little bit later. One of the great consequences of what happened was that two languages and two linguistic cultures and two forms of Jewish ethnic culture that were rich and diverse and intense and fascinating and creative and extraordinary were destroyed. And that is Ladino and Yiddish. But Ladino even more so than Yiddish, because the ultra-Orthodox are preserving Yiddish as a sacred language, but not necessarily as a secular language. So the culmination in this region of Ladino is the culmination of the almost complete destruction of Ladino, which is again studied only by a few, the annihilation of a culture. One other incredible artifact survived. The artifact is the most famous artifact of all of the Balkans, and that's the great Sarajevo Haggadah. And the Sarajevo Haggadah was written in 1354 in Spain. It went into exile from the Spanish Inquisition, and by the way, I have a facsimile of the Sarajevo Haggadah, which I take out every Passover. And one of the most fascinating things in the opening area of the Sarajevo Haggadah is that you have a picture of the globe that is round. That is round. It may not be that Columbus was the only guy who suspected that the world was round. But the Sarajevo Haggadah survived the Spanish Inquisition. It then went to Italy. It finally made it to the Balkans. It made it to Sarajevo. It was hidden, and you got to understand, it was hidden in the mattress of the crib of the director of the Macedonian, of the director of the Macedonian State Museum during the Holocaust to preserve it from the destruction of the Jews. It also later survived the bombing of Sarajevo and the genocide that took place in the 1990s. So we tell the story of freedom with a Haggadah that has now survived expulsion, World War I, genocide, the Holocaust, and genocide. And if you want to tribute to the sense of the endurance of the Jewish narrative of liberation, see the journey that this prayer, that this Haggadah has made throughout the totality of Jewish history. Now let me touch for a moment about North Africa. And let me only touch on it for a couple of seconds because it's a complex story, but let me begin by saying, and this cuts against some of the grain of some Jews who are, you know, want to reread into the Holocaust the anguish and the tension between Jews and Muslims of contemporary time, or Muslims and Jews of contemporary times, which is Jews in Morocco, French-occupied or French-colonial Morocco, were treated far better in Morocco than they were treated certainly in occupied France, and also in Vichy France. The king of Morocco refused to deport his people. He is not honored by Yad Vashem as righteous among the Gentiles because there is no evidence that his life was at risk. But there is considerable evidence that he treated the Jews of Morocco with integrity and with decency, and they were better off in Morocco than they were in even in Vichy France, and the French were able to institute Jew laws against them, but the French were not able to deport them and were not certainly not able to annihilate them, and the king behaved with a certain admirability. In Tunisia, which was under German occupation, there were local concentration camps for a brief period of time, but no death camps. And in Algeria, the 315 of 341 who led a coup against the pro-German Algerian government were Jews. It was an unsuccessful coup, but if you talk of Jewish resistance, you have to talk of the Algerian Jewish resistance to a German allied country, a country that was trying to participate in Germany. Luckily, it happened late enough in the war that the Americans were in the area, and it did not endure for an intense period of time. And I feel a certain intensity of that because my father was one of those American soldiers who was stationed in Algeria. And I've heard this story not from a historical perspective, but I heard it in nighttime stories from my father, where my father's role in the war, I wouldn't say was exaggerated, but I would say was highly emphasized. And I can appreciate that. I'll tell you a humorous story, which is not normally the occasion, but we need a little bit of a psychological break before I wrap up, which is I was at the Royals game last night. And I had, thanks to people in this room, I had the most wonderful seats imaginable. I was right behind the visitors' dugout, as close to the field as you can get, and your Royals are really a team to behold. They may have scored more runs than the opposition, but they really beat them on defense, even less so than offense. But the reason I tell the story is a very interesting one because I got a ball last night. And now I have a real terrible question of integrity, which is, do I tell my kids how I got a ball or do I invent a story? I won't tell you the outcome because I'm still debating. But I understood this because my dad was part of the Algerian campaign, had been through Morocco, had been through Algeria, and had even been through Tunisia, went up into Italy, and we grew up with these stories. Suffice it to say the following, that the essence of the Holocaust was manifested in Eastern and Central Europe, in countries that were Yiddish-speaking and Ashkenazic. But the Sephardim, unfortunately, were wrapped up in this and paid an enormous price. And in certain countries, the price was the entire country. In Greece, it was a vast, overwhelming number, and you could say in both Athens and in Salonika, it is the equivalent of the remnant of the remnant of the remnant. In Yugoslavia, you also had a significant annihilation of the Jews, who then, in its aftermath, ended up in moving to Israel. But in North Africa, the problem was not the German occupation, but was the tensions with Zionism that existed later. And in Algeria in particular, it was the question of Jews, whether they were going to be identified with the Algerian, with the Algerians, with the Israelis, or with the French. And the annihilation of the elimination, or the absence of Jews from Algeria, was an absence that had three times the problem. Some during the Holocaust, small number. Many during the battle over the Algerian Algerian independence, and many also because of the influx of Zionism. But the impact of it on Sephardic culture was, on Ladino culture in particular, was near total. And we see the remnant of that in the way in which you have only very, very small pockets of Ladino without any ultra-Orthodox community that is preserving that culture. So when you look at the documents that you're going, that you've seen or you're going to see, understand the way in which Jews have lived in their culture. Understand the way in which they have learned and followed and borrowed and acculturated the integrity with which they preserve their tradition, the wisdom with which they adapted to their environment, and in certain respects, the brutality of their ending. But in the Iraqi case, understand that the ending was evacuation. And if you go to Morocco, you have the same phenomenon in Morocco with a very different thing. Those of you who have been to Poland, what you have in Poland is you have what I call the presence of absence and the absence of presence. In other words, you have things that are remnants of Jews, but they're not there. And in fact, all you want an image of that, I'll give you the image of that, which is what I do when I'm in Poland, which is there are homes which have had for 300 years a mezuzah on the right doorpost. And now what they have is they have a vacuum where once there was a mezuzah. They have what we call negative space, the void, the emptiness. And whenever I pass by a home like that, I go up and I kiss the vacuum, because it represents those who were there. The difference in Morocco, which is very interesting, is the synagogues are there, the Jewish community institutions are there. The Jews are in Paris, in Jerusalem, in Israel, the Jews are in Canada, they're in Montreal. The institutions they left behind are from the evacuation, but not from the destruction. In places like Macedonia, the destruction was so complete there's barely the remnant of the Jews. And it seems virtually like Poland, but there's nobody who came back at all to tell the story of what happened. And that meant something else in the aftermath. It meant, in Macedonia at least, that it took them a long time to discover what had happened, because it takes a tremendous time to understand that these people disappeared from the face of the earth and would never return. And when you speak to the people who either fought in the resistance or escaped. They say every time in 45, 46, 47, 48, when you had a knock on the door, you expected somebody to walk in. And because there were so few survivors of Treblinka, 100 survivors, 900,000 people killed, they didn't know what had happened to them. Let's take questions. Thank you very much. There are microphones on both sides. If you have questions, please.
I think if you're used to listening to our speaker, you might be aware that he takes about 10 different questions and likes to answer them at once. So please feel free, come on down the aisles, and you can stand at either side. And I look forward to a fantastic answer to, hopefully, a fantastic and quick actual question.
And on the campus of Aristotle University there, they have the gravestones of the former Jewish cemetery are parts of the buildings and the benches. But anyway, I'm kind of wondering, from knowing about the Ashkenazi history, the sense of entrapment for the Ashkenaz, that they could not get out. There was no getting out. And I'm wondering, was this really the experience for most of the Sephardim as well? Did they have as much stricture in terms of could they go other places? Was there any distinction in the countries that welcomed them as to whether or not they came in from Sephardic countries or largely Sephardic countries, or if they're coming in from Eastern Europe?
It's a very interesting question. The answer, and it's very important. I'm going to say it very briefly. If you were a Jew, you were much, much, much better off being in an Italian zone of occupation. The Italians didn't mind persecuting the Jews, but they didn't like to kill them. And that, by the way, I don't say that sarcastically, I say that gratefully. The Italians really went on the death elements with regard to the Jews only after Mussolini had been overthrown and the Germans had invaded. Then they became serious about, serious about killing. But during their zones of occupation, if you went to an Italian zone, you were much better off than in a zone occupied by any of the other occupying forces, including Bulgaria, including France, etc. So that, for example, if you were in Italian-occupied France, you were in great shape, as opposed to Vichy France. If you were in the Italian-occupied zone of Yugoslavia and the Italian-occupied zone of the Balkans, you were in fine shape. You might suffer a bit, but you were not in the same type of peril all the way through. And I'll tell it to you in a... Let me tell two cute stories about the Italians. One is a wonderful story. There was a priest who had a wonderful reputation, and he had taken a vow never to lie. And everybody who knew him knew his great integrity. He was hiding Jews, and they asked him a question. They said, police came, he said, are you hiding Jews? He thought very, very quickly, and he said, how do I answer that without lying? So he said, why would you ask me such a dumb question? I hate Jews, they killed my Lord. I despise Jews, I don't believe them. I think they should all, you know, have converted to Christianity and worship the one Jew that I do revere, Jesus the Christ. Police chief is fairly smart. He says, but you haven't answered my question. So the priest then comes with the thing. He says, well, I told him I'm not hiding Jews. He said, if you say you're not hiding Jews, I won't inspect. And he said, I hope when I go to meet my maker at the end of the days that that's the worst sin I ever committed. as do I. But the Italians never built up esteem for killing, and therefore in Italy with 40,000 Jews there were only 5,000 who were killed, which is seven out of eight survived. That's an incredible, in European context, that's an incredible survival rate. And those Jews who were killed after the fall of 1943. Those killed who were killed in large numbers were killed after the fall of 1943, when the Germans and the local Italian supporters of Germany were fully in charge.
Dr. Berenbaum, your next question is going to come from up the stairs.
Okay.
Yes, thank you for speaking to Italy that way, because I was going to ask you about Italy. My family comes from Italy. I'm a first generation American. And last year we went to the library branch at Crown, at the plaza, and we heard a speaker who wrote a book. It happened in Italy. I'm sorry I can't remember her name, but she did speak to how many Italians saved a lot of Jews by hiding them in convents, hiding them in the hills. And we actually had a Jewish people who were children during that time appear with her, still speaking Italian, because they learned Italian by staying in Italian homes and being kept safe there. I was hoping you would speak to that.
A, I know her. B, I know her work, and it's very interesting. There's a C, though, that we have to ask, which is very interesting. And it's perplexing because of the fact that it is. If I were to evaluate the behavior of the Italians, let me talk about archives for a moment. I just wrote a piece on the Vatican during the Holocaust. And one of the things that I had to say at the beginning is, since the Vatican archives are not open, nobody really knows fully what can happen there. But there was one researcher, a woman by the name of Susan Zuccotti, who did a very interesting thing. She said the following. She said, I can't find out what the Vatican received, and I can't find out what the Vatican sent from the Vatican, but I would bet my bottom dollar that every local parish and Catholic institution kept a copy of what they sent to the Vatican and what they received from the Vatican. Right? If you're an assistant and you sent a letter to the Vatican, you would keep a copy of the letter what? You sent from the Vatican. And if you had a filing system that was better than mine, you would keep a copy of what the Vatican sent back to you, even if it were not written by the Pope. Right? So what she did is she examined all those documents, and therefore she had a very good picture of what was sent, what they knew from Italy, and what they learned from the Vatican. She came to a very interesting conclusion that local institutions were far better and far more decentralized and far more involved in saving than the instructions they received. And that the local Catholic institutions behaved far better, and local Catholic institutions in Italy behaved far better than the Vatican. And that also goes with one other issue, which is a post-war issue that was very important, and that was the question of returning to the Jewish people children who had been saved in Catholic convents and monasteries post-war. And what we have there, which I've just done the research on, is we have three meetings with the Pope regarding that. The three meetings with the Pope were, the people who met with him were all major figures Gerhard Regner, the man who was the operative of the World Jewish Congress in Switzerland, who sent the famous telegram that informed the world of the final solution. Leon Kovetsky, who was the man who requested of John J. McLoy that Auschwitz be bombed, who was with the World Jewish Congress in New York, and the chief rabbi of Palestine, later the chief rabbi of Israel, Rabbi Isaac Herzog. The very interesting thing is that all that Regner said it was the worst meeting of his entire career. And we have one detail that is a report that I have yet to verify, but a very strong report, that Rabbi Herzog felt so strongly about the meeting that he insisted on going to the mikveh to cleanse himself after the meeting with the Pope. Which is not a matter of any laughter, it's a matter of he felt he had been contaminated and the Vatican did not offer help. Interestingly enough, in France, that same man by the name of Archbishop, then Cardinal Roncalli, did return Jews to, did return Jewish kids who were saved in non-Jewish institutions, and he did so against explicit Roman Catholic theology. Because a baptized a Christian is a Christian based on baptism, and if these kids were baptized, they were therefore Christians, and returning them to the Jews would endanger their salvation, and consequently one could not do that and one should not do that. The other person whose record on this is very intriguing is the other recent saint of the church, the man who later became John Paul II, who was a young parish priest who did something in Poland that was extraordinary. In Poland, he insisted that before he baptized the kid who was saved by Poles, a Jewish kid who was saved by Poles, that they had to be informed that they were Jewish. And he did that in 47-48. Now, understand this, that if you trusted a Pole, and think of it in terms of those of you who are Jewish, think of it in terms of your relationship with Christian neighbors. If you trusted a man or woman and woman completely with the life of your child, and you understood that you could not preserve your child, and your child was under the age of 2 or 3 where they didn't speak, you might dare to give your child away because you wanted to save his or her life. More desperate with a man, a boy than a girl, because boys were circumcised. During the war, you could not tell these kids that they were Jewish because such knowledge would be lethal. After the war, because it would not only be lethal for them, it would be lethal for you. In Poland, if you saved a Jew, you were subject, you and your family were subject to killing. After the war, you didn't want to be known as a Jew lover. If the parents returned, you had loved this child, and therefore only with desperation and struggle did you give them up. Abe Foxman, for example, who was such a child, had to be kidnapped by his parents and didn't want to go with his parents because his adoptive family was a loving and caring and decent family that raised him well. And then in 48, it was dangerous politically to tell them because you had not had that, it was dangerous personally to tell them because you hadn't had that conversation for 7 or 8 years. And you then were telling a kid that you're not really my kid, you are adopted, and this is your origin. But John Paul II, then a young parish priest, much to the objection of the most decent people in his own community, insisted that they be told, and only then would he baptize them. And that was an act of integrity, that which then reflected itself in his papacy. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's really been a delight to have you here. One final invitation to you. In Memory Hall, we have an exhibition called A Centenary of Australian War Art. It's an exhibition of Australian war art from World War I through to Afghanistan. And there's a particular piece in there that has a connection for me that I'd invite you to take in that exhibition. My father served in the British Army during World War II, and he was one of those who came upon Bergen-Belsen at the time that the Germans were leaving, and he was part of the liberation. In that exhibition is one of those pictures, one of those paintings from the liberation of Bergen-Belsen. And I'd invite you to come back and see the exhibition, knowing that that's my connection to that story. Ladies and gentlemen, we're so glad that you're here. Thank you for Dr. Berenbaum for his insightful presentation, and good evening.